I'm going to start rocking and rolling. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
How is everyone doing? So my name is Diane Brusher, and I will be your presenter, facilitator for the next hour or so. And what we're talking about is teams and team alignment. So before we dive into our content, I just want to spend a minute or two just to introduce myself a little bit more formally. So again, my name is Diane Brusher. I've had my own leadership development consulting company for about 20 years now, after working for very large organizations like AIG, American Express, GE, and Chubb Insurance. And so my passion and my background really is helping people become more effective in their leadership. So towards that end, I'm going to ask you all, how many of you view yourselves as leaders? Awesome. I love to see that. How many of you are leaders of others? Nice. How many of you are leaders of teams? Awesome. Okay, cool. So that's what we're talking about today. We're going to sort of segue into how do we unlock the power of our teams, right? And so how many of you have ever taken a course on team development? Some of us have. Okay, great. So I'm going to sort of dive into some of the content here, which is, I feel like we're sort of surround sound, like the presentation is everywhere. So you can look wherever you want to look, and there it is. There it is. Wherever you go, there you are. So here are some of the things that we're going to look at. We're going to talk about strategic alignment. And so how do we align our teams to help meet the business needs or the business priorities? So what that means is we're going to spend a little bit of time talking about alignment. We're going to move into developing your own skills to align team goals with the broader organizational strategy. And then we're also going to talk about some of the complexities of strategic alignment and how we can support teams' performance. And so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to talk about some success stories. I always believe in starting with the positive, right? And you seek, and ye shall find, right? So we're going to start by talking about some success stories. Then we're going to move into three core elements of team alignment, which I'll get into. And then we're going to talk about how do we align our team goals with the larger, broader strategy. And then what are some of the complexities? We're going to spend a little bit of time talking about the complexities and then how we can support team performance. So again, as I said earlier, this presentation is really all about teams. Ladies, there are seats up here if you want to come join up here. It's your call. You could stay in the back or you can come on up. There's lots of seats up here as well. Okay, so we're gonna start by talking about some success stories. So this is audience participation time. So who has a team success story that you'd like to share?
I will pass this to you.
Oh, I project, but I'm... good morning, my name is Stephanie Savino. I am a salon owner of Bella Rococo at Amelia's Salon in Garwood, New Jersey. And our team success story is we literally hit 5 years last Tuesday, and it was just me in a dream. And 6 months later, we hit COVID, and we made it through, and we even grew our team, we grew our sales. And it was a really good success moment for me and my team because a lot of businesses closed and didn't come back. So to be a new business and still navigating the first year, but to go through a pandemic, is like one of our success stories, so.
Thank
you for sharing that.
You got it.
Thank you. How about one more?
My name is Donna Zolli, and I work for a company called CGI, and we're a consulting company. Coming out of COVID, the market was pretty hot for people being poached away from our company. So I developed a two-day growth summit for our team. We did an offsite. We did work while integrating social pieces to remind people how important they were to the organization. Our turnover rate plummeted and our productivity rate increased because people felt reconnected. We had some folks that were even hired during the pandemic that did not know each other. So the opportunity to know each other face to face for a contained period of time really helped our company to retain employees and to grow productivity.
So two very different stories with some common themes. Thank you. Anyone else want to share a success story? Okay, so we're going to talk about understanding strategic alignment. And I have up here on the slide two different definitions, and I know they are a little bit wordy, but I'm going to ask you to read two definitions, both definitions of strategic alignment, yourselves, and then we're going to talk about which one resonates more with you, just to get a better understanding of strategic alignment. I'm going to ask you to vote in a minute. Is it door number one or door number two? Okay. Who likes number one? Raise your hands. I see some hands raised for that. Let's just yell out. What are some words that resonate with you with the first one? Harmony. How many of you like the word harmony? Yeah, so I do a lot of values work, like personal values work, and harmony often comes up as a personal value that people have. Like, we want to live in harmony, so that might be why you like number one, harmony. Okay, what are some other words in the first one that you like?
Effectively.
Okay.
Aligning.
Any other words jump out at you?
Achieve.
Yeah. That is one of my own personal values, achievement. Okay. Who likes the second one best? Okay. And what are some words that you like for the second one?
Deliberate.
Purposeful. Integrating. Integrating and maximizing. Those are strong words, right?
Impact.
And if we had more time, we could come up with a third or fourth. But you're understanding a little bit more about what strategic alignment is, right? It's coordinating, it's integrating, it's a process. It's hopefully in harmony versus discord, right? But we are going to talk about that a little bit later on. We talk about some complexities that we might be facing, right? And the other thing I want to point out, a strategic alignment is not just the people part. Right, strategic alignment theoretically also is including processes, systems, people, right? All of it in coordination, sort of like an orchestra leader, you know? Like the conductor tries to organize and coordinate everything to make music in harmony. I just thought of that. Very good. So the three elements of strategic alignment is really aligning our goals with organizational goals and ensuring our team members know and understand goals, right? So I want to talk for just a second about employee engagement. How many of you are struggling with employee engagement? You might have people on your teams that maybe have physically checked out. They're physically there, but they may have mentally checked out. Anybody? Have, maybe we are some of those people ourselves. You don't have to raise your hands for that. So the reason why I ask that question is there's a lot of research that's been done around employee engagement, and people that feel disengaged are people that really don't understand the broader organizational strategy. And that's where you come in as leaders. You can help people understand the broader organizational strategy and help make sure that the work, people understand the purpose and the role of their jobs, so they really understand what they're doing and why it's important. So that's an important part, is a second element. And then the third one is all about communication. How many of you have heard the saying in real estate, location, location, location? Any of us hear that? Location, location, location? Well, guess what? In leadership, it's all about communication, communication, communication. Right? So it's really important to continue to communicate that strategy. So the question I have on the slide here is, what is your experience with strategic alignment? Does anybody have want to talk about some of their own experiences with strategic alignment, or can you think of times that you've had to align your teams?
Yeah, my name is Gifty. I'm an accounting manager at Mendon Saran Partners. So I've had teams where some of my team members in the accounting department were kind of struggling. You know, sometimes when you have a new team member, they struggle to do well or identify with the team. So I had an instance where I had a particular team member who was struggling. There were a lot of errors in her work. And so what I did was to set up one-on-one meetings with her on a daily basis. This is something we do on a monthly basis, but I decided to start with her on a daily basis. So just go through, see what she's working on, what she's struggling with. And as time went on, she got to really get herself into, we moved it to weekly and then monthly, so that at that point she had gotten enough training, enough guidance to be able to work in that sense. So I think in that way, meeting with her regularly, talking through things with them, actually helped her to be able to align with what the other team members were doing.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. I love that success story. It's a great success story. So what I'm also, when you were speaking, it also made me think about the value of coaching. Right? Coaching other people, giving people feedback on a daily basis, and then aligning it, making sure that people understand how their role, what they're doing, is part of a broader team, and then how that team's department, your department, also links into something more broad. So thank you for sharing your story. So now we're going to move into aligning team goals with organizational strategy. And we're going to do an exercise in a few minutes here, so I'm just going to sort of set you up for success. There's three elements of team alignment. One of them is really understanding your organizational strategy and the importance of that strategy. So some examples I have up here is market expansion. Right. So as I go through these, I just want you to raise your hand up and let me know if your organization, if this is one of their strategies. Okay. How many of you work in an organization where they're growing, they're market expanding? Okay. Anybody want to give an example of what that might be? Market expansion. Is it a product? Is it a product expansion? Is it moving to a new geography?
Hi, I'm Crystal. I'm from Unity Bank, and we're extending our branch and lending footprint right now into New Jersey and other parts that we're filling in our footprint.
You're my business. You help me out. Thank you. So you're growing. That's a good example of market expansion, right? Customer-centric strategy. Is that anyone's? They're not mutually exclusive. You can have more than one strategy. Anybody work in an organization where it's customer centric? You're expanding on that. Do you want to say something about that?
Of course. My name is Connie. I am with M&T Bank. We're very customer. Yep, another bank in the room. And we just did a market expansion recently. So both market expansion and customer-centric strategy, we focus a lot on how we service our customers. We want to differentiate the experience they have with us and provide them with trust that they can come to us with any financial problem or issue that they have, and that we can help them with the important things in their lives.
That's great. Thank you. I have one more hand raised in the back.
Hi, thank you. Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Joanie. I own a local ice cream shop here in town. I don't know if this is considered Union, but in Union, Magic Fountain. I want to say that we've touched on both market expansion and customer-centric strategies. I would say customer-centric strategy would be focusing on the needs of our customers. So, for example, there are a lot of people who have, like, you know, diet restrictions, non-dairy. We now offer about 12 options to kind of cater to different needs and different diets. And then as for market expansion, just trying to tap into different target markets by offering things, you know, not only for just children, but adults alike. And that's it. Thanks.
Thank you. Wow. Good stuff, everyone. I'll stay in the back for a minute here. Digital transformation strategy. Any takers on that one? Digital transformation strategy. Sustainability strategy. Takers on that one. Product diversification strategy.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Cassidy. I work for Atlantic Corporate Health, and we are constantly working on diversifying all of our different products. We offer a lot of different health and wellness products for large employers and small employers alike. So we try to continuously meet the health and wellness needs that are always growing, because health and wellness is expanding constantly. It's no longer just going to the doctor. So we work to promote preventing health illnesses rather than just treating them.
Very needed. Thank you. Thank you so much. So do we have a pretty good understanding of strategy, of some types of organizational strategies? Yeah. So I have an example up here. Another one is innovation strategy. So a lot of times companies are trying to find ways to do things faster, right? Or more effectively or more efficiently. So innovation strategy. So I'll just put up here an example here. Strategy emphasizes continuous innovation to stay ahead of competitors. It involves investing in R&D, fostering a culture of creativity, and rapid prototyping. So overview of the strategy, objectives of the strategy, leading the market through innovative products and services, and then there's some goals. Goals that support that particular strategy. So theoretically, coming out of that, let me go back, would be, these are considered SMART goals. We're going to talk about SMART goals in a little bit more detail. It's always so funny. I know in the world of L&D, we love acronyms. But if you think about a SMART goal, if it's not a SMART goal, what kind of goal is it? It always amazes me, those SMART goals. So that's just an example of what we're not going to spend a ton of time on that. But I think this, I've laid this out just so that you can really think about. There's a heading of the strategy. What is that strategy? What is the objectives of that? And what are the goals, the SMART goals that support that objective? Okay. So two more things here. How do we then translate that strategy to goals, and then ensuring that the goals are SMART? Now, how many of you have heard of those SMART goals? So I have two A's in here. So sometimes you see it, and I've always seen a specific, measurable. Sometimes I've seen different A's. So I've either seen achievable often, but I'm a behavioralist. I love action-oriented things. I do a lot of assessment work for leaders, and I do a lot of work to help leaders understand the results of those assessments and creating actionable plans. So I like to think of SMART goals as something we can act on as well. That's why I put the A in there, actionable. And then we have relevant. They have to be relevant to somebody's role. I don't know, were we ever given goals in life that were like, wait a minute, what does this have to do with anything? So it's relevant and time-bound. So time-bound means it's, you know, either by Friday, it's by the end of the week, it's once a month, you know, quarterly, annually. It's got to have some frame of a time, like a picture frame. That's got to be your time frame. So we've seen that before, right? Okay, so who's ready for an exercise? Okay, so I'm going to try to make this pretty easy. I'm just going to explain this to you. It's selecting an organizational strategy. So I have up here there's two strategies. I'll just sort of set the stage for you. One strategy that you can pick, there's one side, it's one handout that's got two things to it. And I'm going to actually ask, can you help me just, thank you. If you can just put some on the table, I'm just going to steal the first one. Yeah, there you go. Yeah, you can just put a few down on each. We're good. And then, so one of them, thank you, ladies. One of them is enhancing customer satisfaction. So we're just going to go through this as a group. There's in your small tables. One is called enhancing customer satisfaction scores by 20%. Or the other organizational strategy that your group can work through is called implementing a new company-wide software system. Right? So what I've given you basically is an overview. And I'm just going to ask you to, oh, thank you. We're not going to spend a ton of time on this because I don't really have a ton of time. But I did want to give you the experience of looking through the strategy. I've even given you some examples of a SMART goal. Okay, so you can look at this and say, okay, I'm going to pick the first organizational strategy, enhancing customer satisfaction scores by 20%. And then it gives you some of the areas of focus. But then what I really, and I've given you even some examples of SMART goals. What I'd like you to do is to come up with one new example of a SMART goal, either for strategy one or for strategy two. So you can organize yourselves. That's all I'm asking you to do is one SMART goal. For either org strategy one or org strategy two. And so you can work with your table mates, your partner, whoever. I'll give you a few minutes to do this and I'm happy to answer your questions. So breaking it down for someone on your team. I've put back up here what SMART is again if you've forgotten.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to give you one more minute, ladies. Few more seconds. How we doing, everyone? We ready to share a few examples? All right. Okay. So first off, before I solicit some ideas, how many of you found this the handout helpful to give you a sense of an outline? I like outlines. I like templates. So feel free to use this, borrow this, wink, wink. however, it makes your lives easier. It's all good. Okay. So who would like to share an example of a SMART goal? And then when you do, just let me know if you're looking at org strategy one or two. Okay, sure.
So we worked on the implementing a new company-wide software system. Okay. And we added a SMART goal, which was to hold a pilot maybe for 3 months, just to see how the new system maybe would go in certain areas, get feedback through a survey maybe from those teams that use it, which would go back to the IT team to help correct or, you know, any challenges that they found, something that didn't work, or what was great and successful. I don't know, do you want to add anything?
No, you said everything perfectly.
Okay. So,
it's a team effort.
Pass the mic.
That's so funny.
Ours is passing the buck.
You
want to
add anything?
No,
you want to add anything?
No, that's good.
Okay. Yeah, so that's what we talked about. Thank you.
I'll let my ladies.
She's a good leader. She's delegating.
I delegate.
That's what I do.
Okay. So we are from Mendonça & Partners, as we mentioned. If you need an accounting firm for your business, please see us. So we are actually in the process of implementing a new software, which we have in a training next month. So we use that to discuss. And our goal is to ensure that at least team managers are 80% comfortable with the new software within 6 months of training. So after going through them, we want to practice it. And within that specific period, we want to make sure that the managers are comfortable with the new software that we are implementing. Okay, so we're going to measure that by ability to use it. So this is the software that we're going to be using in our work. So you'll be able to practice on the software to be able to ensure that you are going through your task without any issues. And as they come up, we have IT to help and support.
Thank you. So it's, you know, comfort can be described. So in the way you were describing it, it's one's ability, right? So how do we, there's tests, there's proficiency tests that we could take of some sort. If you were to share with me that your level of comfort is around my confidence level, follow me. So I do a lot of work with leaders around competence and confidence, because I wholeheartedly believe it's more than one's just ability to do the job. It has to also be somebody's confidence in doing the job. So you can also measure confidence levels. Right? So you can level skill levels. You can also use an assessment around confidence levels by doing a simple rating scale. I love rating scale questions, like on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the highest, 1 being the lowest. How confident are you in completing or knowing about this new system? Right? So I share that because that could also maybe be somehow included in one of your team goals. Yeah. One more.
We also did the software system, and what we would do is we'd like to, our goal is to increase employee satisfaction with our current company. So we would have members fill out a survey where they would define more, like 1 to 10, their more efficient work process. Do they feel that this new software has freed them up to do their core business rather than necessarily bogged down in a paperwork? And then doing a quarterly survey of employees to see if they now feel that the company is constantly looking for better ways to not bog them down in minutia, but rather in their core business to make more money.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And when companies do surveys, right, I know we're also bogged down with surveys, aren't we? Right? So one of the keys when companies do surveys is hopefully we're leaders that go back and share with the people what the survey results said. And hopefully we're acting on what the outcome of that survey says. Right? That's, I think, an important thing. If we're asking people for their feedback, hopefully we're coming back to them and we're sharing with them. It's another way for engagement and alignment. It's one more, you know, it's a good leadership best practice, I would say. Okay, anybody else want to share one? Sure.
Okay, so we did enhancing customer satisfaction, and this is what we came up with. Personally contact 50% of current customers for testimonials, feedback, issues, suggestions of current product within 3 months, to establish a newsletter, blog, some sort of communication to give this information to your current clients.
Nice. Great. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much. Okay, everybody give yourselves a round of applause. You have conquered the art of SMART goals. So now we're going to move on to our next section, which is navigating the complexity of strategic alignment. And so I put some challenges up here on this chart. So when we're aligning teams, sometimes what happens is there's miscommunication or a lack of communication. Or I told so-and-so who I thought would tell their team, and that didn't trickle down. Right? Doesn't that happen? Or there's miscommunication, or there's erroneous information shared, right? So I'm going to talk about the solution to that. So a potential solution to that could be ongoing, relevant, timely information shared. And that also includes knowing the best mode of communication. And it probably wouldn't be text messaging, would it? We miss so much in the context of text messaging, don't we? So really thinking through, do I need to have like daily standing meetings if we're in person, or daily meetings, you know, virtually? Is it okay to just do an email chain? I don't know if any of you have Slack at work. Anybody have Slack or any kind of a channel like that? Teams channels. So how are you going to effectively communicate and get that set up appropriately? So also training your teams to know the right way to communicate. I'm coaching a woman now, and her manager says to me, which I thought was very sort of interesting. He says to me, can you teach her to communicate? You know, like the what and the when. I was like, oh, sure. I can do that. So I'm wondering what he's doing on the job to basically communicate with her. maybe, I don't know. So, well, we're just starting this process, so we'll see where that lands. So the benefit of communicating is transparency, and it builds trust. The more we share information, the more we share about what we know, when we know it, how we know it, it builds trust. And that's an important thing. It's a foundational piece for any relationship, right? So that's the communication piece of it. Sometimes team alignment, lack of buy-in. People don't buy into it because why? They don't know about it. They might not know about it, or they might not have been included, right? So think about it that way. Have you ever had any knowledge that could have been helpful if you were asked and you would have shared it had you been asked? Anybody in this room have that? It does happen quite frequently. So one of the keys to the buy-in is to involve people in the process. And it's simple questions like, what is your experience with this new system? What could be another great buy-in question? Asking somebody about their experience could be one example. What else?
I think a lot of times people who are responsible for implementing something are never the ones who are consulted in how to make it work. And so you're up here making the decisions, but this person down here who uses the system every day is never consulted, and that's where I think things go off the rails.
Yeah. How many of us agree with that?
Yeah. I agree with that as well. That's why involving people as often as you can, as soon as you can, as much as you can. What is your experience with this? Right, and there's a lot of ways you can do this. This is a little bit of change management that we're talking about now, but the number one way to reduce any sort of resistance is to involve. I don't care what level of the organization you're at. The more you involve people in the process, it's hard for me to argue with something that you've asked me my opinion on. I might still not like it, but I'm not going to be totally resistant to it. Right? So the more you can involve people, it will reduce resistance. And so a benefit of that, which is that radio station that we're all tuned into, What's in It for Me? Have we heard that? WIIFM? What's in it for me? Another typical change management technique. What's in it for me? Is it reduces resistance and it supports effective change practices. Okay? So that's another way to help with team alignment. Another challenge that I have seen and experienced in the workplace is conflicting priorities. Have any of you ever had this where we're like, wait a minute, we've got all these strategic initiatives going on here. How do we know what's important, et cetera? So we want to align individual roles with strategic goals. And we want to remind members of our team that the reason why this is a new task or a new role is and how it supports some organizational strategy. So people who are important feel important, and everyone on your team is important. So the benefit there is it helps execute results because people know why they're doing what they're doing, and their role is so important to the organization. It also increases clarity, it increases focus and purpose, and I think equally, it increases employee engagement, which is something that I know many of the organizations that I work with are struggling with. How do we keep and retain talent, the war on talent, keeping people? So those are the ones that I came up with in my experience. I'm opening the floor to you to see if there's any other challenges that you have experienced in the workplace that you would like to share as kind of a challenge.
Even though we're not like corporate, Salon definitely has our challenges. So as like I'm 42, the youngest team member on my team is 18. And then my aunt who owns the building, she's still doing hair and she's gonna be 78 years old. She's like off the boat Italian, yeah. So it's the Gen Z, millennials, trimennials, whatever they are. Like I feel like a challenge is in this beauty industry, like how you came up as an assistant. You can't do a lot of the things like, and social media plays a huge part. So it's bridging gaps between the ages, you know what I mean? And making sure that, like, it's very interesting, the age gaps. And it's being a mother to a 7-year-old boy, I see, like, how I want to make sure I'm, like, raising him as best as I can. But that whole generational thing on, like, work ethic and, like, expectation is a definite challenge. And we feel like, I tell the one girl who is in charge of, like, the training, you have to be cognizant of, like, who's in front of you. And it's always different. Like, the what you may have did, the way we did it, is not happening right now. You know, like, and what we learned in school, they're not learning in school. We didn't have social media. Like, now we're not just hairdressers, we're content creators. If you get your hair done, I'm sure you got your picture taken 100 times, because that's what we have to do now. Yeah, like, you know, like, and then God forbid the lighting's off. But you know what I mean? It's like, it's the age thing, though, with the millennials and everybody. Like, it's very an interesting challenge. And I think it's always going to be, like, a constant thing we have to, like, navigate. And I think it's like that in corporate as well.
Yes. It is, isn't it? Generational style differences. You know, I've heard that for the first time probably about 20 years ago. And even now, I don't know how many generations are in the workplace, like 5 or something like that, 4 or 5. I mean, it's, and I think it is 5. Yeah. I mean, there's still traditionalists, which are, you know, the eldest, I would say, and then the latest generation. So you bring up a really good point. That is complexities, right? Because that can result in some maybe team challenges, team interpersonal challenges, which is something that I sort of specialize in as well. It's the conflicts that could arise from people not knowing or having different frames or lenses that they're looking at the situation through. So thank you for raising that. So these are some complexities. I'm going to move on. I think I'm going to move on here. There we go. So we talked about some of the challenges you're facing. Anybody want to add anything else to your own challenges? Oh.
We've got some challenges.
Time. My name is Shamini Patel from Mendon Sign Partners. The main thing we face is timing. So within the teams, we have like a 4 or 5 team member, but then to get them all work on the same thing at the same time, it's very hard because everyone has their projects going on. So whoever, like, you know, it's always like comes with the time to like meet up and then work it on the projects and stuff. So that's
our solution for that.
So one of our clients, we always had the issues. So we started doing the weekly meetings with them. And then they started coming along, and then we started fixing it week by week. So I feel like as a team, we should meet with the like whole team members a weekly basis or like a bi-weekly basis, so we know what's going on, and then that will increase the communication also, and everyone will know like what's going on yeah. that yeah. particular client. So
thank you.
Thanks for sharing that. There was a hand raised.
Just strategies for managing up.
That's a challenge.
Yep.
How many of us have that? Mm-hmm. Okay, so what could be one solution to the strategy, the challenges of managing up?
Anybody have a strategy for that?
I'm Dorian. I'm the human resources manager for the girls over here in our firm. but one of the solutions that I try to give our staff members, our team, and our managers, I tell them, like, hey, you're going to have to hold them accountable. So the same way that they hold you accountable, you're also going to have to hold them accountable. And it doesn't have to be any shystiness or anything like coming from a malicious place. You know, you just want to do your job, and to hold them accountable will set them on track as a better leader, I think.
Thank you. The positive intent, right? So when we live our lives with positive intent, that also can be helpful, right? Positive intent. Managing up is knowing your audience. Another tip on that is knowing who you're speaking to. Know how they like to be communicated. Do they need to be, want to be CC'd on things, etc.? Everything, certain things. So, because at the end of the day, nobody likes to be blindsided, right? We don't like surprises unless it's our birthday or anniversary. It's true. So giving feedback, learning ourselves how to give effective both praise as well as constructive feedback are additional tips that I would add to that common challenge of managing up. because it is a challenge sometimes, right? So the last bit here is supporting your team's performance. And so here are some additional tips for how do I continue to support my team? And it's providing clear direction and expectations. So if you're really honest with yourselves, right, I'm going to ask you all a rating scale question. I will not ask you for the results of it. So be honest with yourselves. On a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the highest and 1 being the lowest, how effective are you at truly giving clear direction and really being very clear about your expectations? 1 to 10, whatever number that is. No, that's the first question. You don't have to share your number. That's the first question. The second question is, if I were to ask members of your team that same question about you, what number would they rate you? And is there a gap? And if there's a gap, what can we do about that gap? Really, the question is, what do you want to do about that gap? And if you really don't know, there's an opportunity to ask for feedback, right? If you're getting the same question time and time again, maybe I wasn't as clear as I thought I could be. Let me do a take two or take three, right? Because we're always learning, right? We're always learning. And so the second one up here is to offer regular feedback and recognition. I'm a big fan of praise. Years and years ago, I mean, he's still, thank goodness, one of my favorite leadership gurus always would say, you know, catch me doing something right. So I say in life, seek and ye shall find. If you're looking for the positive, you'll find it. If you're looking for the negative, you'll find that too. So finding opportunities doesn't cost money, folks, to give people feedback and to give people recognition and praise when it's, even if somebody's not getting to the goal, praise them for how far they've come. That's an important part of it. And then the third one up here is encouraging professional development and growth. Another key reason why people stay engaged in organizations, they want to see some growth opportunities, they want to get some development and see what you can do to help support that. So I do have this time, so I am going to do this last exercise here, which is a little bit of a practice in communication. So if you ladies can help me again with this. Thank you. I'm just going to steal the top one. So just you're either going to be here, and this is a partner exercise. So you're either going to be the team leader or the team member. So you're only going to there's two scenarios here. You're going to pick one scenario. You're either going to, yeah, if you could. Oh, okay. She's got them all. Okay. No worries. So one scenario is either around improving team productivity. If you're the team leader, you're only going to be reading that page. That's one scenario. Improving team productivity, or the second scenario is enhancing customer satisfaction. So if you're the team leader, you're only looking at the team leader side. If you're the team member, you're only looking at your role. And really, all I'm asking you to do is to practice this exercise. There's nothing special here. I just want you to get in the spirit of practicing. And we're going to see where we land on this. And if there's three of you, one of you could be the observer. How's that? If you decide to do it in a group of three, one of you can be the observer. So the key thing is just decide who's going to be the leader and who's going to be the member. Do you want to improve team productivity? Take about another minute. Okay, ladies, 30 more seconds to wrap up your thoughts. Okay. Okay, everyone. You can find your partners at lunch and continue the exercise. Okay, everyone. Okay. How did your exercise go practicing this? Good? Yeah. Aw, that's nice. I always like it. I call these real play exercises because they're not really role plays, right? They're sort of, you give somebody a little bit of context and then you practice it. So I encourage you, this is an example of, again, the value of communicating. And some of these are tough situations, right? So just finding ways to communicate, finding ways to practice, finding ways to just get more comfortable and more confident in how we have some of these dialogues. So we're almost at our time. And so I always like to end every session asking this same question around your big takeaway. So in leadership, I always believe, you know, my dad was a builder and he had all these tools around the house. And I always like to think about what is it that I'm going to put in my tool chest or toolbox or tools drawers or wherever we have these things, right? So what is your big takeaway from our session today, or our session on team alignment? What's your one thing you're going to say, wow, I'm going to do this when I get back to work?
I think managing every day and communicating effectively and efficiently and getting the feedback from your employees is huge. Yeah.
Great, thank you. Thank you, I wish you well with that.
On a kind of pitching myself to that, I really took away with how do employees like to be communicated with? I think that's, to me, that was my big takeaway. Because.
Thank you. Others. Okay, I see one, and then I'll.
I'm gonna steal your chart.
Good.
Because we do have goals, like in the salon, but just to make sure it's written on paper. When you're in a creative environment, it kind of goes stage left with like the actual order on paper, because we're like really good, but we're creative, so we're all over the place. So just making sure I have more of like a template for them would be great.
Awesome. Thank you. That's awesome. I'm glad.
I think my biggest takeaway was being clear about what my expectations are of people and listening openly to people for what their expectations are, so that we're both traveling instead of next to each other, but as a team in the same direction.
That's important to put all the oars in the water going in the same direction, right? Thank you. Thank you. How about one more? One more big takeaway.
I gotcha.
Communication, communication, communication.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, ladies. Well, thank you again for your participation. If you want to link in with me, you can scan the QR code on the slide and feel free to link in. And if I can help out in any way at all, let me know. I'm happy to work with you individually, work with your teams. I thank you so much for attending and for your participation. Enjoy the rest of the conference, ladies. Thank you.